split push heavy and draws the game out. The Sven Invoker is pretty farm oriented for the first 20 minutes, but gets a lot of team fight potential around 30 minutes in. Yeah. And then you've got the aggressive like sustain lineup, which is just early death ball. And I think that's hard to be able to plan around in a best of one. You're not exactly sure where NP is going to be going with their strat, like which one are they going to be taking, and they all offer different timing.
If Nog is not banned out, will they first pick it?
I bet.
I think so.
Yeah.
I
think every time, right?
Every game. Every game. They haven't had a chance.
They're so good
to play
with that Song of Siren into Arrow.
Like, aggressive
or whatever.
Yeah, super. They play the most aggressive of anyone. They just, they are not frugal with it. They just cast it and run.
We have a draft.
Oh.
The one and only game of Alliance versus NP.
May I ask?
Whoa! No Warlock. There's no Warlock. All right, we did it, everybody.
Naga is up.
Naga is still through.
That's true.
Oh my god, no!
Alliance definitely had this planned out, right?
No! Yeah,
they had to have.
And the crowd.
Much like EG, know that Advent would first pick Darkseer, right? They leave that hero out in the pool. They have a plan against it. Alliance are doing the same thing. They know if they leave Naga Siren out there, NP would absolutely take Naga Siren Mirana. I just don't know what their plan is, because it's not like there's super obvious weaknesses to this combination as there is with the Darkseer.
Yeah,
there was that absolute groan from the crowd as soon as Naga Siren was picked, and then Slack sounded like
it was sort of a mixture. There were like the two guys that were like, "Oh, Naga, I love this team and that team, that hero," and then everyone else was like, "Oh."
My cry was not one of resident sleeper. It was not one of boredom, but of fear. NP's real name is Naga, please. They have never lost a Naga game. These
is this special information as
are
a sub?
Bananas!
They actually did lose a Naga game.
They have never lost fairly a Naga Siren game. They were robbed.
There was trickery afoot, huh?
Robbed like devils. Anywho, Mott, I feel like I interrupted by throwing a pillow at you.
No, please, keep going.
No.
If any team would know how to deal with Naga Siren, those slacks, right?
Oh,
wouldn't
my
it be
God.
Your boys?
My boys, Alliance, I don't know. You can't give Naga to MP. They will destroy you intensely.
Look at this crowd. Talk about intensity.
Whoa, that guy's waving. That guy, too.
Physical move.
That guy in the back. He's
getting hyped.
Yeah, he's getting hyped.
That was EE, I thought.
Well, I'm out.
All right.
Okay, so Alchemist third ban here for NP, Keeper of the Light, third for Alliance. Do you start banning illusion heroes here if you're NP? I mean, like Juggernaut, Luna, Morphling, kind of the top three that pair with the Shadow Demon, if that's what they're afraid of.
I think you would definitely consider banning away a Luna, just because of the fact that that's one way to deal with split push, is just be able to have really good high ground potential.
And we saw it last game. They were, what, behind 20,000 gold, and they still took a rack to the tier 4? Yeah. Like, you just don't want to go against that.
Yeah.
I think it's smart to do that, because right now NP got exactly what they wanted, and Alliance, I think they did as well, because like Cap said, you left the Naga, they're going to take it. Why would they not take it?
Yeah. This team is known for split pushing, even if they do have three different suites on their roster. They have two of the old guards, Alota and EGM, are very well known when it comes to split pushing strategy, so they know what the counter is.
The gift of the Magi again. Good job.
Yes. What does that even mean?
You've never read the Graham's poem, The Gift of the Magi?
No, I've read.
Sorry, Slacks. We all don't read as much poetry as you do.
It's a short story poem about some people that buy each other beautiful combs, a husband and wife, spend all their money on combs, and then the other person finds out to buy their comb, they shave off all their hair to afford the money to buy the golden combs. They both open it up.
So why would he need a comb?
Well, exactly. They get the combs, but they sold all their hair to buy them. So it's just the gift of the Magi.
Isn't that is like the... Yeah, I guess that works. Because MP would never do that. He's all about
I
value.
I see the moral of the story here, Slack.
Thank
I see
you,
what
Mon.
You're getting at.
Thank
but
you.
How do both teams lose?
Right, that's what
in
we're trying to...
In a Naga game, both teams lose.
Both teams just pick up so much split push that the game never ends.
The game's over.
They're trapped for eternity.
The Naga pick comes out, that's it.
Mott, if this game, if these teams going head to head were a World of Warcraft campaign, which one would it be?
I don't know what you're talking about. I can't stand. What are you doing?
Well, I believe this is
throwback to playing your DS.
Grant made a good point, and there's the offlaner for Alliance, Jonas Symphon himself in the flesh, Disruptor for NP. Great combo with Naga. You get the setups with the Song of the Siren. You know, you can usually get some kinetic field static storm action going on after that.
And already you see like a lot of other Naga teams. They just use Naga defensively. This is like the most aggressive Naga lineup. You get a sleep, easy arrow connect, easy kinetic storm, everything. Mm-hmm. Kinetic field.
And I think that's the danger about NP is because of the fact they use it so aggressively. Naga Siren Sleep is not a very long cooldown as you get later in the
game. Especially Octarine Core, 45 seconds?
Yeah, 45 second cooldown? That's insane. That's like a 35 second downtime or something like that.
Yeah, and it's,
so you need to try and pressure them early when they're occasionally going to be able to use Naga Siren Ultimate to be able to get like that one hero pick off with the arrow and then run away or force the fight. What is it? Like Disruptor, Static Storm? But then you have to continue to be able to operate on low cooldowns because you need to punish that timing. Where level one Song of Siren is quite a long cooldown. It's like 160 seconds or something.
Exactly. And I think the biggest thing is we saw other teams try to run this. Like FPL tried to run an aggressive Naga Siren Sleep team, and they didn't like know the timings and all that. And
yeah.
NP just plays perfectly. Now they have the MSS tied under. We have
not seen this.
He doesn't die.
Yet.
We haven't seen it this tournament. We've seen it before. And I remember, like, we casted it. I forget who I cast with. I think Mott, maybe. And his just didn't die. He got tri-lane. He just kept living 5 HP.
He was, like, one of the tankiest heroes. Like, it's just impossible to bring him down. He's, like, that frontline hero is going to keep the Naga safe, essentially, be able to take those team fights if they want to. But
and it's just incredible team fight for NP. The strategy that they're going to go for here is fairly obvious. You've got good setup with Naga and a ton of follow-up. Mirana, not only just for arrows, but just getting those huge star storms on the entire team. This is some serious wombo combo and also lane dominance. That's the other thing with this squad that MP has going on.
Yeah, I'm just... Cav, why do you think they picked Lion? Like here?
They've got both Shadow Demon Disruption on Naga Siren Illusions as well as the Lion, which instantly kills Naga Siren Illusions.
Yeah.
And then I think Lion is a nice initiator versus Mirana as well.
Yeah.
If you can get the Blink Dagger.
Where do you lane Lion?
They might be considering
aggro. You can't aggro Lion.
I don't think
it
you can
so
aggro Lion.
That's the problem with Lion. Just no laning presence at level one. The stun's awful. Voodoo reasonably long. The mana cut's insane.
Whoa. I kind of like this actually.
Terrorblade.
Why do you like it, Mott?
I feel like a lot of the time with the Terrorblade, after a certain level, you could just head to the jungle. And that's you were just talking about this Lion not getting as much experience in farm.
There you go.
Just put him in the lane and have the Terrorblade go jungle for a bit. So that does catch the Lion up to a certain extent.
Do you think they can go aggro trialing with a Terrorblade? For like the first 5 minutes, let's say.
I mean,
they break that apart, but in order to get the 1v1 for Batrider versus Tide.
That's what a lot of Complexity did yesterday, right? They went the aggro trialing against the Lions, but they waited too long to, I think, break it up, right? They were there for too long of a time. So if you do the aggro trialing, break it up quickly, unless you're really dominating the lane, but even then, I'm not sure.
Did you see his shirt?
Yeah,
there's a Tide under and Naga.
For the love of God,
all right, that's disgusting. They know. They knew.
He was like, pay attention. Like a true anime, you know, guy.
What?
He reveals the strat in episode one, and then it's like, oh my God, Kakaku! It was all according to plan.
Alliance gonna be sweating bullets after seeing that one. They're like, oh God.
That internal monologue from Loda, the screen goes black and white. How could I not have known?
So what do they pick for Limp here? Is there an obvious choice? I mean, Limp Puck coming to mind a little bit, a classic
Wasn't
hero for
Alliance
him.
The team that played Middle Batrider? Is there a chance with Middle Batrider
they
again?
Did, they did yesterday,
yeah.
I believe.
Okay, yeah, they still do it.
But they already know it's a Mirana, and that's not a good matchup, so probably not going to be
It feels like a Jonas bat.
Yeah.
I think so.
Oh, they banned Zeus.
I'm trying to think.
Zeus is the standard Terrorblade counter, right? I feel like
one
both these teams are posturing. They're going to get Alliance's Naga, and then they're gonna get MP's Terrorblade. Both these teams are like, bring it on. We're gonna take you the love of your life. We're gonna steal them. We're gonna make babe.
Naga's the love of their life.
What? What?
Whoa, Dragon Knight.
Where did the babies come from?
Oh this God. Is
that hero. Just,
Dragon Knight.
He's not had the success. He's been played a lot and not had that much success.
I feel like DK is the quintessential boomer bust hero right now. He either gets that good early start, has a decent lane, and he feels unkillable, or they shut him down and he feels useless. Like that's been my DK experience
over
the past few weeks.
It's gonna be Mirana middle, so right clicks aren't gonna do anything to Dragon Knight. A Disruptor pretty weak. I mean, you can glimpse his back. There's not big setup to kill this Dragon Knight middle unless they get a huge roaming high damage support.
And their
right
siege
here.
Is pretty scary. You've got Terrorblade with SD for even more illusions. Of course, the corrosive breath from the Dragon Knight.
The one big downside is that these two teams, they have this really good pushing power and they have the ability to force these fights, and I think that's great. Like Alliance needed to do that. The downside is going to be they are a little bit more cooldown reliant, which we talked about. That's the way you could abuse a Naga Siren. Like they've got Tidehunter, Ravage, they've got this Song of Siren early on, very long cooldowns. You could have tried to speed the game up. They're not gonna be able to exploit that as much with Metamorphosis and Dragonite Ultimate all both having a somewhat considerable cooldown.
Yeah,
but I think they did have to go for a push lineup very clearly. I think that their plan is just to try and close off the map, allow Shadow Demon and Lion, even when the Radiance is up and they're trying to do that siege high ground, but they're pushing into a Radiance. They have two supports that can deal with the split push that comes out from those illusions from the Naga Siren really well. They just crowd off the map as quick as possible and just do not give NP the space to be able to get those later items for the Naga Siren, like the Octarine Core and Manta.
So what are we looking at final pick here for NP?
Great set, it's for high damage support or something. Somebody with good roaming potential maybe for the DK.
The problem is they focus on Naga too much. Eternal Envy can super fun. Well, that's pretty aggressive. Okay.
High damage roaming support. I think you guys nailed it.
Thank you.
Well done, Mott and Grant.
It was just him, actually.
I think they have to make sure the Tidehunter has a good lane. Mm-hmm. And Undying really ensures that because his strength is a dual lane support. Like, Tidehunter has to have a good time here because they need to be able to have that early mech to be able to fight against some of the pushes. Because they can't just give up all the lane presence and all the tower pushing to Alliance and be like, oh, we're just buying time for Naga-san. They do have to fight.
All right, gang, we got to predict here. Slax, we're going with you first. Who's taking it?
Oh, MP. Yeah.
Yep. I will go.
Jesus, way to jump ship
You were all over Alliance.
And all, but you gave him Naga. I don't know what the hell you're thinking.
Yep.
Good luck.
I'm going with the Undying NP.
I want to say just Alliance, if they win the laning phase up to 10 minutes, they just push down towers. One missed Ravage could mean a missed Rax, but I think NP in the long run will win it. But if Alliance has a good first 10 minutes, I called it.
All right.
Just so you know.
Okay. I think I actually am going to go with Alliance. I actually really like the DK pick a lot. I think they're going to do well.
Well, I think Alliance, if they manage to push in Raxes by 30 minutes,
I already called it.
Alliance will win. But if not, NP will win.
Bold claims from the panel here. Let's see what our casters think. We've got Annie and ModPax here for this best of one.
Thank you very much, Sayori. We have got a heck of a game elimination on the line. It's just a best of one. I'm Android, being joined by ModPax. What are your thoughts on this crazy draft?
Well, I'd have to go with some of that deep panel knowledge there and say that if Alliance don't destroy the throne, I think NP could take it.
Starting things out with the smoke gank here. Alliance moving up into some unfriendly territory. They get down a nice ward, but again, NP, similar story. Just going to be smoking up, moving into the Radiant Jungle. No one going to be bumping in, but there is a chance to play some really nice vision now. Who's going to get the most out of that early vision? 30
seconds. Well, in terms of like the whole laning setup and where that vision needs to go, I did like the way the Alliance kind of kept themselves open, right? They went this earlier Batrider, something they ran in the mid lane, and then of course can just be forced into a 1v1 to give yourself an advantage, and it's starting to look like teams are closing in on each other.
And towards that mid lane stuff could go down on dying, a pretty ambitious first target, but it seems like Alliance might have the damage. Their level 1 skills are pretty conducive to teamfights.
And it's time to wrap.
AUI would sure like to get that kill. EGM gonna ping it out. They're just gonna be Undying, spraying out some harass, but well, EGM is gonna back off and no blood spilled just yet. Do you think we're in for a quick, heavy push lineup with the Terrorblade, or is it just gonna be that slow, sweet Naga Siren victory?
Well, I think you gotta follow what Grant pointed out there, just in terms of like that quick rolling over of the lanes with the Dragon Knight and a Terrorblade too. If they get a little bit of control on either of them, you can just get some quick towers.
Courier Snipe attempt, look like it's not gonna be successful this time, and SVG pretty keen on what's going down, gets some vision of EGM, pings him out, and we'll chase him back into the river.
Yeah, so the kind of expected here again, right? Alliance are gonna go aggro try here. They have the Batrider for the best in the 1v1. We had a really interesting one with Monkeys versus that Tidehunter the other day where Tide just completely dominated. I don't think we'll see that same advantage here. I would expect the Batrider to definitely come out on top. Should allow him to rotate early and perhaps even go into... It really depends. If he gets a couple kills, he might go like right into the drums, keep up his farming, keep up his own scaling, and then back for the blink. Or if they want to get really aggressive and maybe try and get some kills with Dragon Form, he could go for a straight blink, which is kind of more the Alliance style.
All right, Loda in this aggressive off lane, really trying to keep the pressure up. Not only does he need to farm his own Terrorblade, apply early push, but he needs to shut down this Naga Siren. It is one of NP's most dangerous heroes. What's the best way for Alliance to do that?
Well, they're staring at it right now. It's always scary going to an aggro trial, not only up against a Naga Siren, she can be a great support or a core in these situations, but then there's the Undying as well. It's definitely a difficult task here for them, but they're attempting it. We'll see if they can drive them up. It looks like they largely have at the moment. I mean, the supports are just chilling up here for now.
Yeah, we're going to see EGM try to find something here, but, well, Terrorblade.
They're making the rotation.
Bottom lane, there we go. Switching things up, just going back to try to get the most farm on Terrorblade as possible, because, you know, Alliance is going to hit a relatively early peak. They're going to want to fight with that first big Metamorphosis. They want to get towers down, so it looks like Loda is just going to get aggressive on this Tidehunter right away.
Yeah, and this is exactly what we talked about yesterday, when NP had their matchup, when Complexity had their matchup there, where they tried that strategy up against Alliance, right? Like, they saw what happened to Complexity, where they had this Terrorblade up in the offlane, and they had their Beastmaster safe. And the whole plan for Complexity was to get that Beastmaster crazy farm and allow for a very early push, so then you could dominate the rest of the map while Terrorblade got big. But they let the Terrorblade up top too long. He never came online. He was level 4 at like 10 minutes, and Complexity just couldn't get their game, you know, together at that point. So Alliance may be learning from watching that happen up against them, so they're going to send him back down a lot earlier and still give him a nice lane up against the Tide.
Yeah, I definitely like this flexibility coming out from Alliance, not afraid to change up their lanes to give themselves a better shot towards that mid game. Now EGM coming in, maybe wanting to go onto MSS, it's going to take an Anchor Smash, but starting to spray out some poison, again, it's really difficult to actually lock down that Tide and do enough lethal damage, but up top, it's looking good for NP. AUI's farm not slowed down too much, and he will take over the last hit lead.
Yeah, and there's nothing a Batrider can really do here. Like, what can you really try and achieve up there? He has three last hits. Best chance would be he heads the jungle now.
All right, EE having some success in the mid. Is he going to go just immediately in for that Aghanim Scepter, or are we going to see any stepping stones along the way?
I think he'll probably just be the standard kind of stuff, right? Maybe grab yourself a ring or whatever. Maybe your phase boots, too. Seems to be more common these days. We don't really get the brown boots Aghanims, but as was just pointed out there by Lurkiderp on the stats, the 3-0, right? This Naga Siren, Mirana Arrow, they're so good at setting those two up.
We're going to be seeing something get set up down bottom. There is going to be an Earth Spike to follow up after the disruption. MSS taking a lot of damage, but he's got the 2 points in Kraken, and they just can't do anything to him. Oh, MSS, come
on. Attaboy. That's how we do it.
I just want everyone to be friends. Back in towards the mid lane, the farm fest is going to be continuing. Mirana's last hitting a little bit low here, as Limp is really controlling up the lane. Is that what you expect, or do you want Mirana to be a bit more aggressive?
Yeah, no, I think this looks pretty similar. This is like your Dragonite versus Puck, same kind of idea, right? The right clicks just aren't really there, generally how you hope to try and control it, and he's just a little bit too beefy. Even more difficult for Mirana, too, because he is getting nice and close, trying to harass with the Starstorm, especially if he wants that double hit, and Dragonite can easily punish that, reducing the damage to the Brief Fire. Pretty easy time here, doubling up now in CS.
Our Undying rotating around, trying to find some kills. Lion is pretty low, creeping around the jungle, but looks like he's going to be safe for now. Handskin making his way into the lane. So not a very bloody game so far. We're at almost 5 minutes in, and there has been no bloodshed.
Yeah, you think the opportunity would probably be on Yoas? As he's up here now, doing a nice job of just going into the camp. Come back over the Firefly. Could be in some trouble if he comes back. But our Undying has gone down to now help with the Tidehunters. That's why Yoas has to be a little bit aggressive here. And of course, the earlier levels, we all know Disruptor tends to suffer a little bit there.
Yeah, he's super, super level oriented. So once he gets his 6-7, I think that's when NP can really start to go and rotate. They're going to bring the Undying in. They can commit a Naga Song to get some really nice setups.
Yeah. Setup really is the name of the game for them, too. So many nice combinations. You have Ravage into Static Storm, you have Song into Static Storm. Even during the Song, you can get into a nice position for a Tombstone. It basically, like, the Song ends and just chaos will be ensuing there for the side of Alliance. And you know, what do they have to deal with that? I mean, you look at the Dragonite, he's got a nice stun, it is instant, so if you're in the wrong position, you might be able to punish that. But they only have the Disruption apart from that. So it's going to be very important, the positioning here of EGM, to make sure he can save his cores.
Alright, so looking at farm momentum here, you'd really like Loda to be able to pick up some stacks. Speaking of Loda, he's having some technical issues, hopefully we sort that out. But Handskin on our Lion was able to scout out the Ancient stack going on the Dire side of the map. Is that something that Terrorblade can Metamorphosis for and take right away?
It might be risky, just because you're putting Metamorphosis on cooldown. Currently, NP, they don't have the best Ancient Heroes, right? There's no spam or anything here. It's more of like a recovery mechanism for the Tidehunter, especially when he's dueling with the Undying. And that gets a little bit more delayed than someone like your Sven, as well as it takes much longer to take them. So with that vision there, essentially, rather than blocking the stack, they've got one in the back too, but really having that vision over it can sometimes be just as beneficial because you know when you need to come and contest.
Yeah, we'll see if there's going to be any contests coming in, but still, everyone really wanting to focus on their individual farm. We're really setting the pace for our tried and true Naga game, but I think we're going to have our first big team fight fairly shortly, and at that point, you're already getting heroes with their ults up. Dragon Knight has picked up his dragon form. Arana is ready. Naga is ready with her song, so this could get very, very violent quite soon.
Yeah, there's, I mean, 0-0, and again, one thing we've seen, I believe it actually was MSS playing the Tidehunter, but we hit a couple games lately where it's, like, Ravage isn't even thrown out for the first 30 minutes. Just, it's so important to have that as a threat. It's become much more like that Enigma Black Hole than I think it used to be on the Ravage. Like, teams used to rotate a lot and try and get that first big kill with the Ravage at level 6 on the enemy position 1, and maybe we will see that just because of the importance of the Terrorblade, but a lot of times, teams just kind of want to, you know, chill it out, move together, hold that Ravage. Don't do anything too crazy. They don't want to be punished by that dragon form and metamorphosis if Ravage is down.
Exactly. So it looks like we're going to be moving in. Pressure onto the tower prioritized over any sort of kill attempt onto SCG. They just want to get as many structures as possible because, of course, NP's split push Naga game gets filthy towards that late.
Yeah, NP already long gone in this case, and they will find
EGM. EGM. I think he's in a little bit of trouble here. He goes for the self-disrupt, but it's not going to buy him enough time. Looks like the zombies are waiting eagerly to start smacking on him, and the first blood will go to MSS down in the Radiant Jungle.
All right, Team Canada scores first here. But in terms of the objectives, it is Limp. He'll be grabbing up the first tower in the top lane.
It's going to be nice here. Jonas trying to think about something. He's level 4, so his lasso still a ways off. Are we going to see him go in for the drum, or does he go back for the early blink?
I think in this case, just because of how they swapped him out, moved up the top lane, he didn't have that dominating matchup, it will probably be the Blink Dagger. Try and get a little bit of that momentum rolling, really be the whole gank squad with the Dragonite and then punish after into the objectives. What we were probably expecting him to go for.
EGM is able to steal up one of the Wildwing Rippers, and they're going to bring in Limp just to kill the rest of the farm, so making sure that MSS isn't getting an absolutely uncontested stack here. But Tidehunter still had a really successful lane. He's getting a good amount of last hits. His levels are pretty spot on. Going to be getting that Ravage in just a couple of moments here. So seems like NP are getting the tools they need to have a very, very successful big fight with the Ravage, with the song. Static Storm going to be online for Disruptor soon enough. So their team fight Wombo is terrifying.
Yeah, and as you see pointed by Pimp, they notice it's blocked. But sadly, that one ain't going to reach.
EGM going in, steals up a bounty rune, just keeping MSS at bay. Meanwhile, the cores still aren't getting what they need. Naga feeling really uncontested now in the safe lane.
Is that, is that outside? That observer by the Ancients? It's so close! Oh, it's like right on the line up there.
Oh, no!
The pixels. Okay, so that's huge. But it doesn't look like they'll be able to contest it anyway. With the help of the Undying, Tidehunter, it can take a little bit longer, right? He's only got 0-2-3 right now, but with the help of the Tombstone, tacking up some of these right clicks, piece of cake grabbing this up, and a lot of farm now to MSS.
Yeah, Alliance definitely wish they could have gotten their paws in there, but again, just keeping vision of the area, making sure that at least Alliance know where NP are focused so they can start to split up and get some good farm.
Yeah, you can see the Metamorphosis now popped immediately in the mid lane. They understand, Tombstone's down, they're at the Ancients, we gotta try and punish as hard as we can on these towers. But sadly, it is really only one. Limp's gonna come over now. But party's over.
Oh, immediate stun, followed up with the dragon form. So Limp, just not messing around, goes in for the breath, and there is going to be Undying getting away with a little bit of health to himself. AUI now moves forward. They are going to start things off with a song.
Seen this before.
Yeah, it looks like this DK might just end up being the sacrificial lamb while the rest of his team still tries to focus down that tier 1 tower. Ravage committed, clips onto the Shadow Demon as well. EGM with the self-disrupt. I don't think he's going to get out of this one there. They've got all the tools in the world to keep him down. And it looks like Loda just going to be backing off, grateful for his own life in that fight.
It really is amazing to watch, to be honest. You think that sentry's close to that observer, you see how close that arrow is before the song is disabled? I mean, it's unreal. Like, just moments away from it being a null stun, and they're always able to connect on it.
Oh, up here in the top, we are going to have a little initiation here as Batrider gets a bit greedy going in without a whole lot of vision, and will get punished by the rotating NP. Radiant's bottom tower is
under attack. Now 4-0 here. NP looking pretty hot. Now cooldown reliant, of course, though, with the Ravage, with the song, especially in the early game. 3 full minutes now where you might be able to posture yourself aggressively, not have to worry about that. And look, you can get a glimpse into the sack, throwing down the Lion.
That's a big commit here, but they are able to find Handskin pretty easily, and that's going to be a killing spree out for Eternal Envy. His farm is starting to stack up, really terrifying for Alliance.
Yeah, level 7 on the Disruptor, really finding the levels here for SVG. Quite excellent, of course, as we find out for the Disruptor in all cases, whereas we've got level 5 on both the Lion and the Shadow Demon for Alliance.
Yeah, I mean, you can't really count Alliance out yet. It's looking rough in terms of the kill score, in terms of the net worths, but they are getting the tower advantage they need early on. We're at 10 minutes in, they've got 2 tier 1s down, and that's going to be Terrorblade's big strength going into this, but of course, the later it goes, the more likely it is that Naga builds that momentum, that Mirana is able to really contribute to these teamfights.
Yeah, you look at the net worth, and again, it's not too shabby, right? So probably gonna have to turn things around pretty damn quick though, because AUI is moving away with about 2k gold, that's right.
That's really not the way to do it there, Limp. Tata in a very hard place here. Possibly Dragon Form is gonna get disrupted up. EGM trying to bring some help, and now Loda comes in. They might actually be able to turn this. Loda doing whatever he can to keep his allies alive. Limp is still up. Moonlight Shadow protecting heroes temporarily. EGM gets munched off into the trees, but is there going to be any sort of follow-up here? Jonas moving forward, looking for something, but isn't going to be able to catch any lasso targets, and that's going to be perhaps another tier 1 going down. They do find the Undying as a consolation prize. So Alliance's push keeps up, but NP still going in and getting those continual picks.
Yep, nope, that's definitely good for Alliance, though. Yeah. I think huge for them. Starting to control up around this area, around the Roast Pit, even just this Dying Ancient stacks. Despite the fact that it's more of like an early game thing, where like you just stack it up and you get that Sven or that Luna really huge. Same thing with this Tide that we saw here. Still important going to the mid game. I mean, you still want to control that. We know how efficient NP are, so it is super important they have mid tier 1 and the bot tier 1 down. We'll see with the cooldowns now coming back. We have the Ravage, and we'll be soon back into the song as well in about 10 more seconds. And here already on the hunt, but passing through some observer wards right now from the side of Alliance, so they're already starting to rotate around that. They need to abuse this as fast as possible and try and focus somewhere else.
Mid lane, Jonas going in, doing what he can to Aoi. There is going to be that song available, and look at these TP rotations. With no blink on the bat, it looks like there is going to be an easy arrow setup. They get him down, Lion drops the finger, but AUI is still barely alive. Damage a little bit miscalculated there, and they will end up getting Naga back to base safely.
Whew. Close one.
Yes, sir.
All right, well, I mean, that's one way to stop the push, right? Putting that pressure in the mid lane, they have to all rotate, so bottom lane will be fine here for Alliance. They can come down, farm this up, maybe get some experience on these supports. I'm still lacking ulti on that Shadow Demon, in fact. Rough game for EGM, 0-3-0. But he's getting the ward down, you know, he's really moved into this position 5 role, you know? Everyone, kind of classic EGM, was always that 4, and Ponskin himself was more of the 5, but since he's now moved into this captaining, he seems to be more comfortable on the 4, and EGM, well, he's, I guess, transitioning.
Yeah, it's pretty difficult. You can feel that urge to rotate and make the plays and go and be real obnoxious there. Loda, meanwhile, getting his farm down bottom. He's doing all right for himself. He has the full Dragon Lance. Looks like he's going into a Manta next, so excited for that.
Yeah, they are spotting here on the wards, but Envy's up top, so no real concern here. Things have slowed down. Momentum's stalling. Feeling a lot better for Alliance. Like, the past 3 minutes have shifted a lot for them. In fact, so much so that they're gonna smoke up themselves. Heading up into that dire side jungle. No vision. This will probably be largely just a scouting mission to try and get down some of that vision. Perhaps they could be concerned about a dire side smoke even wrapping on towards the Batrider, but they're not gonna find anyone. Looks like that was the play, hoping that it was actually NP getting aggressive.
Yeah, for now, just going in. Alliance's wards are pretty defensive at the moment. They don't have anything deep, even though they do want to get Loda up onto the tier 2s as soon as possible, because that's going to be Terrorblade's strength. You know, 15 to 20 minutes, he can get out that Metamorphosis, he can start tearing apart towers faster than NP can counter, usually. Although they do have the Song and the Ravage, and now here in the river, very quick Hex, but Hanskin may have bitten up more than he can chew here. Early Glimpse means he's not going to get caught in the kinetic field. The rest of NP are looking to rotate into this, but is it really worth a full 5-man rotation? And they're going to get things turned around here. Moonlight Shadow comes in. Is there vision on Alliance? Looks like they might be struggling here. Flamebreak coming back in. He's sitting in the Firefly, and they are able to get a kill on that Disruptor. Looks like they're waiting for the Moonlight Shadow to expire. Jonas continues to drop out the Napalm, but I think that's going to be the end of the fight for now.
Yeah, and what's the big difference there in that fight? It's no crisp setup this time, right? There's no simple pickoff from a Glimpse, and there's no Song into the arrow. Didn't waste any of the major cooldowns for NP. Of course, there's no reason not to throw that as a Disruptor. By the time you respawn, it's back in like 20 seconds anyway. No big deal.
Yeah, the big thing here is it opens up the mid lane for Loda to go in, because they know there's not going to be a Naga Song available. They know Disruptor's going to be in the grave and not able to go for those aggressive Glimpses. So look how easily this tower's melting down with the Metamorphosis.
Yeah, and there you see how important those crisp initiations are. One wrong move, and there she goes. And that's with Ravage up, Tombstone. Of course, no Song, but still very well played now inside of Alliance. And well, I guess closing in on the Roche, probably that bottom tower as well will be the next big goals here for Alliance.
MP, they're looking good as well. I mean, clearly they've still got a kill lead. Their map is getting a little bit smaller. They've got a little less space to work around with. Alliance picking up some of that momentum moving forward. But you can't tap out a Naga ever. Naga's doing really well in terms of her farm. Relic is going to be her next.
Yeah, big target on her back right now. If they can find her with that Shadow Blade now up on Limp, that would be huge for them. The Blink Dagger from Jonas, now is the time to get aggressive. Get farming for the side of NP, rather. But Alliance need to catch them out, get some big kills.
It's like Jonas moving around, just keeping the scouting up. He has his blink now, so can be a bit more aggressive with those initiations. Does he go back for drums, or did he just go into force right now?
Yeah, just into like your force staff. Gems can be pretty clutch this game as well. They want to deny a lot of division from the side of NP, just so AOI won't feel super safe roaming around the map.
The Moonlight Shadows have already been a little bit annoying.
Yeah, those as well. Does look like NP are going to safely secure themselves as bottom tower alliance, largely on the opposite side of the map. The mechanism does now come in here for MSS, a little bit late considering the stack he took too. They've really shut him down.
Yeah, it's like everyone from NP focusing this, and they are giving away a lot of vision right now. You see Alliance, they're like, all right, we know where NP are. We know that Naga Siren's not going to come rushing at us with the song right now, so let's get aggressive here. Batrider cutting a wave. Tier 2 going to be exposed as soon as the creeps hop up to it. So it's time for Alliance to get real mean.
Yeah, unfortunately, not able to really get too much done for them, considering like just how much of that movement was telegraphed from the side of NP, at least to us. With the smoke and everything, Alliance are definitely playing super safe. But this time they don't get that trade like they did last time in the mid lane, so big win there for NP. They've now the ones who are opening up that control on the side of the, our right hand side of the map with the Roche and everything. Now they've regained a lot more around their Ancients. And you can see like they've even created a little bit of a wall down that middle part of the map with some observers here too.
Loda continuing to farm. Is Terrorblade doing enough here? He's top of the net worth chart. He's participated in a lot of pushing towers here, but you know, we're 20 minutes in the game. Eventually, Naga's just going to start to really spiral out of control with her momentum and her soon-to-be Radiance.
Moving on forward now. The Moonlight Shadow looks like just a little bit of a defensive one. Concerned about the movements of Jonas trying to find somebody out, so he'll be unsuccessful in his attempts. Still not really getting anything with his Blink Dagger. And that can really hurt a Batrider, right? You want to get stuff going right away. On the other hand, though, Hanskin now is going to have one for himself. So when they actually do get a gank going, double Blink Daggers are going to be huge for Alliance. We talk about the crispness of NP and how important that's been. If he can get in those backlines and disrupt that stuff, it would be pretty huge. Of course, not that easy versus the Radiance, though.
Yeah, definitely not something you're going to want to be up close and personal when you need to go for that Blink Dagger. But I do like this idea from Alliance. The Ultra Mobility, NP, you're going to want to fight in a pretty small corralled area. The Ravage, the Static Storm, the Kinetic Field, you kind of want to get everyone huddled up. And Alliance aren't going to be doing that this game. They're going to be spreading out, trying to flank you, come in from all sides.
Yeah, there's no vacuum or anything here. So nothing can force you into a bad position from the side of NP other than your own movements. Now, the thing is, though, they can capitalize on like any moment with Song. You know, the second they see three of you grouped up, you can be punished. So Alliance, like at all times, even when they're just out moving as a group of five, they need to be extremely cautious about their movements.
NV now has enough money for his Aghanim Scepter, so that's going to be a big change. NP suddenly bringing a lot more damage into these fights.
Yeah, that goes along with the whole setup game too. Just an immediate blow up of, especially one of those supports, something like the Shadow Demon.
Yeah, even the Lion is, you know, he takes the double Star Storm and then he's one arrow from death.
So far the disruptions, although we've only had a couple engagements, they have been very nice from EGM. A lot of our Shadow Demon games so far the storm have kind of felt like the hero's fallen off, other than that illusion spam. Seems like he just has to get a little bit too close, and then there's always too much follow-up anyway after the disruption. Kind of felt like that in that Athenem game, where every time he got disrupted, you never really felt like there was a chance he was going to live anyway.
Yeah, it's unfortunate here. NP go into the Roche pit. It looks like Alliance, they know something's up. They know that NP aren't responding to the push into the top lane. They're probably pretty keen that this is happening. They're smoking up, and they should be able to go for a very classic trade here. First Roche for the tier 2 tower top.
Yeah, I don't know, actually. It's falling pretty quick, and honestly, they haven't got the wave quite there yet. Pretty yeah, that's a major loss for Alliance. I'm just going to call it. That's pretty
NP, they've got their TPs. They've got their Ravage and the Song. It seems like maybe NP can go back and contest this, but they have a one fight in their own jungle right now.
There's Moonlight Shadow coming out, too.
Oh, man, this is getting ugly
Sentries.
There.
Don't believe the Rain have any down yet. Surely they'll pop some, probably in one of these tree lines.
Seems like Alliance, they're pinging something out. They know Limp is very scared now, taking the Star Storm. He's pinging. He needs his allies here, but his allies just want to escape with their own lives. Can Dragon Knight really get out of this? He's going to get slept up. It looks like he's going to get cornered.
It's worth the Star Storm, honestly. I mean, really want to.
What's he going to do? Try to Dragon Tail you and run away? There's just too many bodies.
Well, that's an issue.
Yeah, he's got a Shadow Blade.
That is a problem.
All right, they just didn't anticipate that. You talked about the gem being absolutely crucial here, but they're just out of stuns. They can't catch up to him.
Nah, not going to Ravage
NP,
for it.
NP, I get fooled by a Shadow Blade.
That's rough. That hurts.
And they had scouted the Shadow Blade out previously. He had shown on the map with that item.
Yep. Well, despite the nice movements to create that scenario from the side of NP, unable to capitalize on the fact that Alliance couldn't push through that tower with a disruptor, like with the
Would that have been different if he dropped the Static Storm immediately onto the Dragon Knight?
No, I mean, he's still gonna get off Shadowblade, right? Doesn't matter at all, so. Oh. Go for their lasso.
Going back in.
They have everything from the lion. Should be a dead Envy here, it looks like.
Yeah, they can definitely keep him comboed down. He's sitting in the fire. They commit a Finger of Death for this. It is only going to be the Aegis, but definitely a worthwhile burn.
Yeah, they don't really have enough vision around the map right now, just to guarantee that there won't be enough support from NP. So take care of that Aegis, right? Momentum now back on your side. Huge couple plays here from Alliance, despite the catch of NP. Just lacking simple detection. You know what happens, though.
And NP are definitely playing a very patient game here. They know they could be rotating around a little bit more, going in a bit more aggressively with the Moonlight Shadows, but they're not feeling that time crunch. Again, with the Naga, they know they've got a huge window to be able to go in and get that push done.
Yep, it'll be Alliance's turn now. With the Aegis burned, feeling themselves, they're just going to kind of reset. Use that Shadowblade now with the Batrider. Going to go in, look for some picks. Target they don't want to see, going to be MSS, of course, with that Kraken Shell. They don't have anything that stops that. You know, there's no Doom or the Disruptor, one of his arch nemesis for the Tidehunter in his Kraken Shell. Not going to be options available to Alliance. So they basically want anybody else. But again, like even if you don't get them dying, the Tombstone comes down. That can stop you from pulling away, create a bad engagement. There's going to be the song that comes out from the Naga Siren. There's a lot of things that make that initiation very difficult.
I think the name of the game, again, like we talked about, Alliance rotating in from all sides and not getting corralled by NP.
So it's starting to look that way. Start pressuring themselves up the top lane, throwing out those illusions. But NP are dodging right now, starting to posture themselves down bottom. Radiant's farming up the jungle, AUI. More than likely going to slowly eclipse Loda on the overall net worth as he starts moving forward and do a couple different items. Blink Dagger for NP here now too. More combination, better catch, even still.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot from Alliance, aside from like standing in the Firefly that's going to make that a really tricky blink. And looks like NP really want this bottom tower, and you can totally understand why. Getting those two towers down in the bot lane totally opens up the Radiant jungle to NP to farm up. Naga Illusions are going to be able to score for more and more gold, and the Roche Pit advantage is going to be huge.
Yeah, they don't have MSS with them, and they're also missing Eternal Envy too, so they'll have to back away. MSS going in straight for the Greaves. Yeah, gonna pass over the Blink Dagger, at least for now.
Oh, here we go. SVG might be in a little trouble. Dragon Form committed to this. Moonlight Shadow coming in, but there's the sleep. AUI trying to turn this around. They're gonna be able to TP both of their heroes out safely, and that's gonna be a full Dragon Form down. Is there anything Alliance can get done with that, or do they just have to cut their losses?
There's still room, right? Level 11, so now you've got the 2 minutes rather than the 3 minutes when you're still just using that level 6 ultimate of the Naga Siren. But the window's closing. That gets even harder when you get to level 16, and it's not even just the gold, of course, for AUI that's going to be accelerating now with the Radiance. It does come into the experience as well. So soon he'll be leveling up into 16. He's got himself almost into the Octarine core. Some pretty classic Naga stuff happening here, Annie.
Yep, AUI definitely not changing anything up. He's going for what's tried and true, and it's working here. Getting very, very close to Loda on the net worth chart. And Loda, he's grabbing a BKB for himself. How's that going to change these next couple of fights?
Well, if I'm taking a look over here on the side of NP, it looks like an earlier BKB might be something that NP are going to be okay with, because I think SVG is building himself into a minus. So in terms of your BKB timings, it looks like NP are kind of happy taking this one a little bit later.
Yeah, they know there's not that huge time crunch. They can easily just wait out Alliance. Terrorblade's window of relevance.
Ace as well. Yeah. With his BKB.
They're going to be pretty spooky towards the mid, and that's where Alliance can shine. If they go in, if they get all the exterior towers, if they get a lane or two of racks before Naga feels safe getting all down and dirty in these fights, then maybe Alliance can get enough of an advantage to just kind of start ratting things out. But at this point, NP, they're not losing structures at an alarming rate. They've got plenty of time to farm up, and they're definitely keeping themselves on par with where they should be.
Yeah, I think next Aegis is probably going to be the most important thing in this game. But still quite a while. 3 full minutes, we'll even know the time that thing's going to spawn. Envy losing it just so quickly last time. Radiant's middle tower
is under attack. Towards the mid, Envy just continuing to wail away on this. I don't think that Fortify is going to stop any of the damage. Up top, Alliance are going for a trade. They're trying to get this tier 2 down, and looks like it will be falling. NP not going to take the fight just yet, but if it goes any deeper, they may feel safe defending their high ground here again. They've got the spells they need. Naga Siren needs to pick up a bit more mana before she's able to pass down.
Yeah, double BKBs. They push pretty fast here. I mean, you're always going to force them back. You forced out the glyph, but it has to be pretty fast here from NP, and they need to be careful, right?
Yeah, again, Loda's BKB is ready to go, so they've got to time this Ravage pretty well. Envy just dropping a lot of damage there, cleaning up
glimpse.
The entire creep wave. And a Limp maybe in trouble here, does get glimpsed back up, but again, he's got his little Shadow Blade. He's going to be turning this around. Loda goes in. There's going to be the Moonlight Shadow. Can they actually break this TP? Looks like they're not able to do so. And Loda escaping from that Song of the Siren.
A little too fast here.
Oh, there we go. The sleep does catch up with them. Now Loda could be in some trouble. Four staff forward. Very nice work from his support. They will lose Handskin, but definitely worthwhile to keep Loda alive. EGM try to man up here. Don't really know if you're big enough to take on five heroes, but at least making more space for Alliance to get their cores out. Flame Break is going to be keeping AUI back for now. Loda, can he walk fast enough to dodge out this Naga?
Oh, wow, that Rainy's must have been close. So close to canceling the blink of Jonas there. Supports are just diving on grenades all over here from the side of Alliance.
Oh, the glimpse back does connect. Unfortunately, the bat not going to be able to TP out of this. The damage is there from NP, so looks like NP don't give up the chase, and they are rewarded in the long run.
Yeah, such a risky play by Alliance. I mean, I feel like they felt that strength of the double BKB, but getting glimpse back there, then you're forced into this kind of weird posturing. You can't just leave Lint behind. And MP, they've got the catch. The blink dagger up on Envy, as you just saw. Now the Octarine Core there for AUI. He can't run from this Disruptor and Naga Siren draft.
Yeah, Naga's just so fast there. She'll just chase you down and hunt your children. Good God. They're going in for this tier two. It should be easy pickings. Alliance is high ground. They're definitely not drafted around that hardcore defense strat. They want to be the ones pushing. They want to be the ones initiating. Can Alliance hold this, basically?
It's tough. It's pretty much all on Jonas, and he's got a lot of things he needs to be dodging out there. He's got to be watching for the songs. He has to watch for even just being glimpsed back, static stormed right away as he jumps in. If there's any vision inside the base from the side of NP, they can so easily predict what he'll try and do.
That is a high-value carrier. Will be protected this time.
A couple tomes now bought up. You know, he's a little bit jealous there, I'd say. You know, that hand of Midas on Disruptor, he's like, really, man? Come on.
DK scaling up into a Silver Edge here, so we got enough use out of that Shadow Blade. Is that going to be the end that changes it all here? They go into the Hex, they might be able to find a Tidehunter
here.
MSS is going to be stunned up by the Earth Spike, but AUI comes back in, gets the net off. They are able to finish off the Tidehunter with
no
the Finger of Death.
Himself.
And looks like Jonas going back in will be able to grab up the Undying. He gets off his Flesh Golem form, so he's a bit tankier to deal with, and this could be mana drain as well. The Earth Spike barely clips in, and the Breathe Fire will get him down. Undying out, they're going to be focusing down the Tombstone. This is a great window for Alliance right now.
Yeah, similar to the catch on NP. I mean, we talked about the double blink there from the Batrider and the Lion paying off in spades right there. Hanskin, he's looking so good on those Earth Spikes, too. Chrissy's that, like, four-man one up top to stop the Rego onto Loda. He needs another one right there to make sure they'll guarantee the kill on 1437. Now moving into a Glimmer Cape for himself, which is finished.
Yeah, this Lion's found a lot of farm around the map. You would have thought it would be difficult with so many greedy cores. You gotta get farm on your Terrorblade, you gotta get farm on your DK, but he found his Blink Dagger really, really well timed, and now he's gonna be able to get the rest of his support items.
Yeah, now not only can he blink in to disable and stop some of that follow-up damage, he can also Glimmer whoever's stuck inside the Static Storm, try and reduce that damage. Obviously the Starfall coming down from the Mirana as well. A lot of great things to have a Glimmer for this game.
We are approaching the 30-minute mark, so when's that turnaround going to be there, where Terrorblade, no matter how slotted he is, starts to feel just a little bit less strong than our Naga?
In terms of like the right-click war, eventually he does just win out, right? He builds up those big items, he's got the Metamorphosis, he's just going to town on you, taking your buildings, but in terms of like overall lane control, it's honestly just going to be so difficult for Alliance to ever really get back on top. You're looking at this Octarine core, just spreading them around the map. You've got the Yasha now almost into that Mantis style. Like, the game only gets worse, honestly, from here for the side of Alliance. I feel like they might not feel like they have the strength right now to go forward, but it's starting to look like they really need this Roche to pressure into a high ground soon.
Yeah, you've got Naga able to go and push out lanes aggressively, and then if things get a little tight, if NP are like, all right, top's pushing in a little too much for my comfort, you can just send in Eternal Envy and one Starstorm will clear out an entire wave.
Yeah. A lot of nice options for overall map control for them. Genetruce right now there on AUI, which means all of his illusions around the map are getting that too, denying out the vision from the side of Alliance. We've got to be careful against some high ground wards.
Limp, I don't think he can afford this here. He's going to get dropped. He pops into his dragon form, gets off the BKB, but there's just too many damage.
He still has the Silver Edge too, but that gem.
It's got Jonas trying to look for something there. There is going to be the Tombstone there as well. It looks like they're able to get the Undying down first. Alliance, they're doing some serious work here. Loda with the BKB, the Metamorphosis is doing a ton of damage. Finger of Death comes out into MSS again, but the song just stalls it out. There is going to be a TP out from MSS, and I don't think they've got any sort of damage to get him down. He will be able to TP away. DK does fall. They trade for two supports, but still, NP are happy with that.
Yeah, geez, I know they play it close on the arrow thing with the song, but come on, with MSS. AUI, please, a little bit tight there. It's going to look like SVG getting left behind on those Pitlord ults.
Now, this is a little good for Alliance, just because they know the song is down. They know there's TPs out, so no one can TP back in immediately. And Loda does feel safe to send some illusions and push the tier 2, but now Envy, he's going in, just completely dropping the Shadow Demon. Oh, no. arrow.
Reinforcements are coming, but now he can't stop the TP, so it'll get himself out of there. Okay, so that goes from pretty bad scenario, potential for Alliance to maybe start posturing forward into the Roach Pit the second that DK was up, to now our Shadow Demon's down, two heroes dead, NP gonna start rotating in, try and get some control over this area. It's being pinged out here by 1437. It looks like they're just gonna go for it.
Yeah, I mean, there's no way, even if Alliance knew exactly who was in the pit, exactly where they were positioned, they just don't really have Roche fight spells. What are they going to do? Try to bat lasso someone out and then just get focused by the rest of MP?
Yeah, it's a very tough fight for the side of Alliance. Like, you basically only have Batrider, who's like god tier in terms of fighting around the Roche pit, whereas the side of NP, you've got the Naga Siren, who's pretty much the queen of the Roche pit, and then you got your Disruptor, your Tidehunter, and your Undying. Just four fantastic heroes.
Yeah, Alliance trying to use this moment of silence on the map to actually farm up their cores, push out the lanes, but it does seem futile. Again, you can bring in Naga Illusions and push them right back out, and Alliance, no matter how hard they farm, are not going to win this overall war with a Naga Siren.
That's certainly not looking that way right now. They got to find themselves a good fight into an objective, but NP are doing a great job controlling these lanes. It's no surprise. I mean, this does quite literally get banned out first phase every single game, and we're starting to see why.
Yeah, maybe Alliance thought it was, they could deal with the Naga Siren. I mean, what are the best ways to deal with the Naga?
Well, obviously the BKBs are kind of a, up and down sort of a scenario there. They can focus you down with the song if you're BKB'd, but those saving songs are a lot less effective. You're already winning the fight and you still have your BKB going. She can't just, like, save all her allies by popping that thing. So now with it up, boom!
Under the tower!
Envy, don't!
Envy, please be kind!
A little bit of a risky play, but no quick stuns coming out, so it's okay.
Yeah, NP have the confidence for this, and honestly, even if the Mirana fell there, NP can still have that fight. They can still go in. If they need that pause button, they've got the Naga Song, so it's not like there's any really huge danger to NP as a whole.
Yeah, still holding Ravage, still holding Tombstone. How do you fight into this right now? You just can't. The Song into Static Storm, it's too scary. Even with his BKB Scotty on the Terrorblade, he can't do it all himself.
I mean, you really have to focus on your initiations here. It's going to come down to amazing Blink Lassos from the Batrider, and there is a lot of follow-up. I mean, if you get Loda right-clicking on a target, he can take pretty much anyone down fairly quickly.
Well, Alliance are starting to be shut in here. Yeah, it was difficult enough on the map before you started losing heroes, but with them kind of dropping one by one, the furthest they can get a lane is now bottom with Olympia, and there's already an illusion from the Naga Siren moving in to change that scenario back around. Vision being denied everywhere. Starting to use some high ground ones, which is good, to stop the Naga Siren from always being able to take care of them. They've got one really nice hidden ward. This one you'll often see up against this exact same scenario where they've got the gem. Yeah, you sneak it up there, right in that mid lane, up by the old tier 2 for the Dire.
And be looking to close things out. He has gotten so much use out of that Ethereal Blade. That has killed the Shadow Demon, killed the Lion numerous times, and he can just keep going with it. He's got 3,500 gold. Does Mirana go for something like a Hex? Is there a Lincoln that he needs?
Grabs.
Oh, he is going to be grabbing him.
Still Aegis.
Batrider going to be moving forward. They've got the Hex. This is a combo we've seen before, but this time Naga able to play that Ambulance roll. Eternal Envy is burning. Can he actually get out of this? A Flame Break coming in. He's Mana Drained down, but able to heal up. The Greaves putting in some work, and there's going to be a Ravage turnaround. They've got a Static Storm on too. It's not looking good for Alliance right now. And they're going to be moving in, trying to focus down Loda. And he's got his BKB up, Batrider as well. Looks like the damage will stop here from NP. Can they escape unscathed? And it looks like they will be able to do so. Glimpse onto Limp, just making sure that Alliance do not follow this fight up the stairs.
Well, we talked about no force positioning. And that's the situation right there. You know, you just always have to have it in your head. You can't be that close to each other up against this NP draft. Or else the double stack storm just comes out there. Fantastically played by SVG for sure. But Alliance need to ensure that's never going to happen again.
And buyback on the DK is really costly. We're only 34 minutes in. You really need that money to start building up your DK, because clearly Terrorblade isn't capable of doing all the damage on this team.
Yeah, it looks like DK is basically going to be like the supporting cast, this TB. He's got his BKB, he's got his Silver Edge. Has he purchased up anything else into that courier yet?
Nope.
That was a quick one.
Pimp Muscle, come on.
He's going deep.
All right, looks like Mirana will be in some trouble. There is going to be that big Aegis popped right now due to the Lion Finger, but again, you've still got Aoi feeling super, super safe. The big ults are down on NP, so they've got to fight this a little bit cautiously. But then again, Alliance, they lose their Batrider initiation. They know that Terrorblade is not just going to walk in and try to right-click you. They need some sort of jump here. Now Limp is going to be caught up in the kinetic field, just taking some damage, stuck in place, rooted in place from the Naga Nets, but it's a slow, steady tick damage from NP, whittling down this tier 3 tower. Fortify coming out from Alliance as they are just completely confined to the this area behind their tier 3s.
Yeah, this is all even without the threat of a Ravage, too. See if they back away at this point. Batrider's starting to come back up. It's good enough time as any, really.
Is this a draft weakness from Alliance? Are they just not picking enough initiators for themselves, or is it NP just playing phenomenally tight?
I would say it's not necessarily a draft weakness from Alliance. Like, it is a good strategy. You understand what they were trying to achieve. They just didn't hit the timing. They didn't get that, you know, all those big lasso plays. He bought Blink, and I don't think he had a lasso for like four and a half, five minutes, maybe one somewhere in there, but it wasn't that consecutive momentum of just, okay, we got a group, we got a smoke, we got to get this kill. NP, they're kind of known for this. I mean, not only do they play well when they have the Naga and they're very good at controlling the lanes, but even when they don't have her, they're very good at forcing you into certain positions on the map and not allowing you to go for these five-man ganks, at least without it being super obvious and telegraphed. So NP just dodged that Batrider. Four straight minutes, the Moonlight Shadow helping out a couple times to make sure MSS didn't get caught too. And once they pass that little bit of a hill for NP, I think they just feel so much confidence at this point. You can see, overall, the net worth, it was really close this whole game because they were just spreading around the map as Alliance. NP were just dodging, but it reaches that critical mass point for the Naga Siren where you just can't move the lanes anymore. And now with the kills starting to flood in, immediately sky raining down to a 10k lead.
We'll see how well Alliance are able to deal with this. Again, Batrider, he's still doing well. He's still got some decent time left on his BKB, so he's not useless. He can still get really, really important grabs that turn the fight. If they're able to grab the Mirana and lock her down, if they're able to force a Ravage that doesn't get anything fruitful, then Alliance can take a fight and they can push very quickly off the back of that. That's the key point, that if Alliance find a window to push, they can clear lanes and they can clear structures faster than almost any other lineup right now.
Yeah, the scariest part though is that Aghanim Scepter's almost done here for SVG. So these BKBs, they're one true hope, about to be almost useless.
Hey,
UI, look at that play.
That is a three-man sleep, and EE just crawling in.
Take your choice. No, they don't like it.
Oh, Jonas looking for something, but the blink away from Mirana might be enough to save their lives, and now Jonas is out of position and has no more tools to get himself out of this. He's going to get netted up. The arrow comes in and will connect, and it's going to be a static storm as well, so AUI is dominating now, getting down that Batrider, and he does not have buyback. Alliance now fighting completely stunted. Their initiation is just not there.
Yeah, now the gem handle over as well. So the vision game just gets even more difficult for the side of Alliance. Excellent pick off there onto that Batrider, and that basically secures SVG his Aghanims as well. So I'll be flying it on the courier too.
It's like NP, they're not going to go for mid, they're just going to clear up the jungle, they can wrap around, finish off what they started bottom, because the creep wave is halfway up the lane, not too far.
Yeah, at this point there's no reason not to really just wait for Roche. I think 20 seconds is just a little bit too little time to head in towards that bottom racks and do anything too beneficial to your squad, considering the risks that you would entail. So, Alliance, what are they going to do? Probably have to try and get on the map, maybe even try and steal themselves a Roche. Even, although it seems very unlikely, like, what other choice do you have? They're going to smoke up now, get a little bit aggressive. They send out the illusions from the Terrorblade. Honestly, this is the best lanes have looked in a damn well long time, so Alliance really hoping for something big here. Everyone's up, everyone's moving, and will NP read this one like they have so many other ganks from Alliance this game?
At this point, this is Alliance's Hail Mary. They're leaving their base. They've got their initiator walking around on his own here. This is really dangerous.
They spotted him on that ward, too.
Yeah, they know Jonas is here. The vision from NP is just phenomenal, of course, with that gem. It looks like Mirana going to be walking around trying to trail that Batrider. If they get him down here, that could be huge. The arrow shooting in will not connect. That could have been absolutely detrimental. But now Jonas knows the arrow is there. He's going to bring in the rest of his team to try to find dire heroes. They're going to see Naga illusions, and now Naga knows what's going on. We are in for a big fight. Naga song to start things off. They do catch out Jonas. It's a great way to start things off. Can he blink out in time? Looks like no. They are going to be having that static storm coming in, but oh my, Lymph is able to go to a fair amount of damage there. Rapid coming in, and it looks like they are able to do something. They are going to get down Mirana, and that's going to feel really nice. Hanskin, meanwhile, getting punched up, and there we go. That's going to be Tidehunter spending his Ravage, and Lymph still trying to chase down, but Alliance is starting to go. Thunder will keep Loda up for longer, but is he going to win this right-click war? It looks like the wand of Naga Illusions will end up tearing him down. AUI doing a phenomenal job there, keeping focus, and that is a full wipe on Alliance. They've got buybacks. They can get Terrorblade and Shadow Demon back in this. GG not called out yet. Again, we are in elimination territory. If NP secure this one, Alliance are out of the Northern Arena Beat Invitational.
Yeah, I mean, it's great, it's terribly, right? All these illusions around, I can sunder anybody I want, but sadly, you can't kill them all. So despite going back into full HP and Loda, he still goes down with relative ease there.
Yeah, you could
able
feel,
to blow up Envy was great, but...
You could feel the panic from Loda when he's being chased down by like 400 little Nagas that are chipping him out at every step of the way.
And now up to a 14k lead here. NP looking very strong. Well-practiced strategy again here from them, one that they've done numerous times, and one that many teams simply weren't willing to face. It looks like for good reason here.
You're at a bad point where your Shadow Demon is trying to make illusions of Naga illusions just to be able to take on the Naga illusions.
Yep. Good pick in that sense, but at this point now they've taken a pretty dominating control over this game. Roshan will be respawning here shortly in just under a minute, and from there NP likely going to be able to close this one out. The question is, Alliance, what do they got in the tank? Only one Rax down, so certainly not totally GG in that sense of overall lane control, but with the Naga Siren always pounding in, it just feels so difficult. They got to try another one of those smoke plays, and this time the smoke goes a little bit better.
Yeah, it'd be a little bit different if Alliance still had lanes pushed in the favor, and they could, you know, grab some Boots of Travels, get in, and go for some split push like we saw in our previous series, where you just go and take a Rax before the enemy team has a chance to react. But Alliance have so much work to do to clear out the lanes to actually position themselves in that aggressive manner, and NP are just going to be super keen to that.
Yeah, you can see they're picking up the Blink Dagger here on the Dragonite too. Just, again, maybe trying to blow up one of those bigger heroes, just like they did Envy in the last fight, as they still don't have smokes for another minute.
Alliance feeling safe, fighting out of their base here. This could get pretty ugly. AUI start things out with a song.
Look at that Batrider too. I don't think I can see him though.
Batrider
spawn now.
Is able to blink in.
Nope.
It's going to be moving forward. They are going to get a Static Storm going out, and it's going to do a lot of damage to the Terror Blade. He will go down. He does have buyback immediately coming back into the fight. There's a BKB, so limps won't get glimpsed. And now AUI trying to fight. There is going to be the Dragon Form coming back in, but there's the Kinetic Field. Can they actually stop this Dragonite? Hell yeah, they can. There's the damage coming out of Armorana. So much work being done with that Star Storm. Now Loda, he's walking around. He cannot afford to go down here. If he goes down again, I think it's pretty much over. Can they keep him controlled? MSS moving forward does have the Ravage Defense. Looks like he is going to pop it up with the Disruption. There might be the save they need. Arrow not going to connect, and Loda looks like he's moving forward. He does have a Thunder, and will be able to do some damage to 1437, but still having to deal with the fight.
Oh, that Reflection.
AUI not going to get hit by the Reflection. EGM is still up, still fighting, still spraying out Shadow Poisons. Looks like Batrider going to be moving forward. Does grab up MSS. Do they have the damage to get him down? He's going to go through.
Envy's coming.
And, all right. That's going to be a gem on the deck. NP, they do get a little bit out of that fight there. They force a buyback from the Terror Blade. They get the Batrider down without buyback, but they do have to cut their losses and go back. They can't finish it all right now.
What a player, Envy. He has just been on fire this game. He's looking for all those opportunities, even ones that look a little bit difficult for him. And as you can see, 12-4 lately on this Mirana.
Whew. Yeah, he's having a fun time.
Crash for them, but NP, pretty solid. But I think Envy's played fantastic. Again, certainly here, he's been playing a lot lately, but these opportunities where he's really diving into those big E-Blade kills, it is something that, you know, kind of classic Envy, because when he gets punished, we all love to go a little Envy on it, but.
All right, so NP clearly looking like they are in a much stronger situation. Their team fights have looked good. Their lanes are looking really good. Is there a way for Alliance to get back in this? If they go in for a perfect initiation on the Batrider, if they follow up with crazy damage from the Terror Blade, is there even hope?
I mean, there's always hope, or else they would have GG'd out, right? Like, we've seen bigger comebacks before in the history of Dota 2. There's no question about that. Is it going to be easy? Nope. I think the Disruptor is one of the best heroes in these situations when he has the Aghanim Scepter. Just disabling your entire net worth, it just can't be like underestimated at all. You saw what happened there. You're okay getting a one-man Static Storm, because there's not going to be any BKBs.
All right, looks like we are going to be heading back into the game here. We've got more action for you, finishing out this series. Again, elimination on the line here. One of these teams will be going home.
Looks like they're still okay. There we go, there we go. Now we're fine. Just want to make sure. Good. So, Dire side, still controlling. Roche back up now at this point. Team's a little pause to take a breather here. And the E-Blades, that Hellbear, I'll teach him a lesson there.
He's getting low. He'd sure like a regen rune right about now, but he's going to buy up a TP. I'm pretty surprised he's still holding onto his phase booth. It seems like Booth of Travels would, at this point, be a lot of use for him.
Yeah, he just got a lot of bank, too, so he'll probably start making some changes in his item build overall here in a moment.
Yeah, I mean, what does Mirana go? Is it worth grabbing a Lincoln to try to defend against the Lasso?
Yeah, certainly, honestly. I don't think they need any more damage. The Disruptor helping out with that. She's actually going to move into... Oh, sorry, that was someone else we swapped over. So, yeah, we'll see.
Thanks, Mopax.
It's actually Loda who's building up into the Bloodthorn. So that could be interesting. Again, something a Lincoln would help against, but... The Mantis from our Nogstein's gonna help with that. No real defensive items from Envy other than he could E-Blade himself if he gets Bloodthorned, I suppose.
Smoke coming in from Alliance, they're looking for something here. Envy leaping forward, Terror Blade gonna be scouting that one out. Seems like the Roche is gonna be a hot contest, and of course Batrider is ready to go. He's got his Blink Force Lasso, starting things off with the Firefly.
Yeah, certainly the play they have to make. I don't think there's any question here from Alliance. can't give this one up for free or else the game will just be over. But Limp scanned out here from the side of Dire using the Moonlight Shadow.
And they're going to be crawling around. Can they find him? There is going to be that Dire Sentry in the river. Of course, they've got some vision as well. The Radiance doing some burn damage. Now there's a sleep. They're actually going to change targets a little bit. They dropped the Tombstone here. And will DK be able to get out? It's looking unlikely there. The arrow not going to connect. The song doesn't end in time. Disruption from EGM. Will it be enough to save him? When the EGM goes down, Limp soon to follow suit. And they're looking for more here. Batrider, can he actually find a great lasso? AUI separated from his team, but not going to be punished for that just yet. They've got Tidehunter moving in. He's able to go in for the Ravage. He's going to get hexed up, so buying Alliance a little more time, but they do end up losing their Lion as well. It's now just Loda versus the world. They get a nice drag back as Undying will be brought up to the cliff, but 1437 isn't really the danger here. It's going to be that Ravage coming in, and they are able to get down Loda. He's got no buyback. GG, well played coming out from Alliance now. As NP will move on in this tournament, we have to say goodbye to our Alliance team right now.
Yeah, I think NP just executed so flawlessly in the strategy. Like, honestly, the way they moved around the map, how can you beat that as Alliance? You know, once you miss that timing, obviously that was their one way to beat it, but once that's passed, NP would have had to make some pretty grave errors, I'd say, for them to bring that one on back.
Yeah, I mean, that was definitely a fun game to watch, but there is a reason Naga is banned.